Hey, this is my second movie review, and it's part of the Resident Evil-a-thon that I'm doing. I forgot to mention that the first movie review is part of the Resident Evil-a-thon, but it is. And I'm doing a review of all the movies, Resident Evil movies, and some of the key games in the series. So that's my Resident Evil-a-thon, and today, our movie is, what is it? Oh yeah, Resident Evil Apocalypse. That's the movie for today. Alright, so today's movie, Resident Evil Apocalypse. Let's get started. I'm gonna do the same thing I did last time. I'm gonna read the plot, then tell you my thoughts. So here we go. It kinda took too long on the last one too, so I wanna hurry up. Okay. The film begins with Alice recalling the key events from the backdoor first film. On September 29, 2002, 13 hours after the initial T-virus outbreak in the Hive, the Umbrella Corporation sends in a research team to reopen the complex. As the team enters the Hive through a secret insertion point beneath Raccoon City, the entire team is slaughtered by zombies and lickers who have been sealed within the complex. Realizing the entrance is now open and the virus and infectious zombies will make their way to the surface, Umbrella establishes a security perimeter around the city to keep the citizens in a quarantined area. As civilians reach the checkpoints, Umbrella operatives screen them for traces of any infection until Mayor Timothy Kane orders all checkpoints to be closed as the infection already reached the gates and informs remaining citizens to return to their homes. Wow, that sounds like a good idea. Meanwhile, Alice wakes up in a downtown hospital and recalls her recent memories. After surviving the Hive, Alice was recovered by Umbrella and used for experimentation. She has gained superhuman powers by the T-virus bonded with her blood on a cellular level. As she exits the hospital, she recognizes the virus recognizes that the virus has escaped, causing devastation in the streets, and makes her way to a police car where she grabs a shotgun from the front seat. Elsewhere, Olivera. I'm just gonna say Carlos, alright? I failed at that pronunciation. Okay. Elsewhere, Carlos and two other Umbrella soldiers. Are you kidding me? I'm gonna say Nikolai? I don't know. And Yuri link up with multiple special tactics and rescue service units in an attempt to hold against an onslaught of zombies in the street. However, they are overrun, causing Carlos and his team to fall back with an infected Yuri, who was bitten during the battle. Jill Valentine, a STARS unit member, together with Terry Morales and Peyton? Wow. These guys have such weird names. What's up with this movie? Retreat to a church where they are attacked by lickers before being saved by Alice. When the infection reached critical stages, Umbrella dispatched their nemesis program to kill all remaining STARS operatives. And when he encounters LJ and 13 other members of STARS, they open fire on him before he guns them down, sparing only LJ's life when he drops his weapons. Dr. Charles Ashford, a key Umbrella scientist and creator of the T-virus, has refused extraction by Umbrella until he has located and rescued his daughter, Angela. As he hacks into Raccoon City's network of closed circuit cameras, he determines she is hiding out in her school and contacts Alice and her group. He informs them that Umbrella's method of sanitizing Raccoon City is by nuking it. Really? This sounds like what happened in Alien vs. Predator Requiem. Oh yeah, and I forgot to say spoiler alert, because I'm giving away the end of the movie. So, yeah. Anyway, sanitizing Raccoon City, blah, blah, by nuking it. But he offers to arrange, but he offers to arrange for an evacuation. Yeah, again, Alien vs. Predator Requiem. An evacuation in exchange for for rescuing Angela. Inside the school, the group encounters Carlos and his team, who have also been given the same offer. After various encounters with zombie dogs and infected children, who kill Nikolai and Terry, respectively, they succeed in finding Angela, leaving the remaining survivors to escape and head towards the extraction point. When contacted by Alice about their success, Ashford gives them the location of the extraction point before being intervened by Major Kane, who has been aware of his plan, and captures him before killing him, forcing Alice to fight Nemesis. As she defeats Nemesis, she realizes his true identity, her former friend, Matt, and refuses to deliver the killing blow. Her mercy appears to rekindle a trace of Nemesis' formal humanity, and they join forces to attack the Umbrella troops. Nemesis is killed in the ensuing fight, and Alice and the others escape in the helicopter, leaving Major Kane to be eaten alive just before the city is nuked. The helicopter is caught up in the blast radius and crashes into the Arklay Mountains. Alice is impaled by a loose metal pole. Before being recovered by Umbrella, she is taken to the Chicago Umbrella Research Station, where after several weeks, she awakens in a giant water tank, completely regenerated from her injuries, led by Umbrella scientist Dr. Isaacs. The doctors release and begin to question her. At first, she appears to have no memory, but soon a rapid series of images of recent events come flashing back in her mind, and she states with contempt, "My name is Alice, and I remember everything." She fights her way out of the facility, showing some of her darkest powers yet, only to be surrounded by dozens of armed guards. Suddenly, Jill, Carlos, and LJ pull up in an SUV disguised as Umbrella employees. Carlos shows the guards a written order placing her in his custody. They allow Alice to go, and as she enters the waiting vehicle, she sees Angela in the back seat. As they drive away, Angela asks Alice if she is all right. Alice doesn't respond, and Dr. Isaacs is shown saying, "Program Alice activated." A close-up of her eye shows a flashing Umbrella logo as the film comes to an end. Alright, so that was the movie. That's the recap. Sorry if I didn't sound too enthusiastic about reading it. It's just, it got a little boring. But that doesn't say the same thing about the movie. The movie was pretty good. I gotta say, the first movie was better. First movie was better, but that's usually how it is. You know, first movie was better, but the second movie was still pretty good. A lot of the corniness in the script went away. You know, like in the first movie, some of the script, it was a little off. I just didn't see that same problem in this movie. I mean, it was there, but it wasn't there as much. And special effects, pretty good, but you gotta understand, if you watch the movie now, you're gonna say that they're pretty bad. The special effects are pretty bad. But you gotta understand, this is 2010, and the movie came out in 2004. So, you know. I mean, now we got this whole fusion camera system with 3D and all that, and got our own 3D LED TVs, PS3s, you know. They didn't have all that stuff then, so, you know. It's a whole different system of doing stuff. So anyway, special effects look good, makeup was pretty good, costume design, same thing, pretty good. A lot of people were kind of pissed about Nemesis being defeated so easily. And you know what? I kind of agree. You know, he did kind of go down pretty easy, but that's just how it goes. So, yeah. That's a good movie. I forgot to rate the last one, Resident Evil 5. Oh my god. Resident Evil 1 got, I'd say, 4 out of 5. Resident Evil Apocalypse got, Resident Evil Apocalypse gets, I don't know, 3.5 out of 5. So, yeah, good movie.